questions.
So last day you introduced general differential operator.
Yes.
So can that same trick be applied for doing in couch space time? Suppose del mu is replaced by du, and then the integration d4x is replaced by square root minus.
Yeah, that you can do, but in a couch space time, for example, you cannot do momentum expansion because you lose translation invariance in general. Right. So if you have a fixed background space time, right, you can try to set up this general formalism, but you have to generalize it by allowing momentum non-conservation.
So,
yeah.
Can you have some derivative interaction, derivative terms in the interaction, then we saw that there was some rule by which we can write down one expression for all the diagrams.
Yes.
By using cyclic permutation.
By symmetrizing, yes.
But if I don't use that and draw one diagram, like you gave some example for the 4-point function and two vertex.
Yes.
And if I I want to write down the one expression for that diagram and want to count the commutative factor, could you explain how to count that? Because you said
suppose you have something like this. And you have the feature that two of these have momentum, one doesn't have, right? That's the feature here. Suppose you take a diagram like this. Okay. Let's call this 1, 2, 3, 4. So now, you can write down the expression for this diagram, right? That's not an issue. I mean, the issue is about the commutative factors, right? So now suppose you take the line 1 and you ask to how many lines can it connect, right? You have two vertices, right? So there are 6 lines coming out of the two vertices, but only 2 of the lines have without derivative, right? Because 4 have derivatives, 2 have no derivatives. So line 1 can connect only to 2 of lines, because it can either connect to the line coming out, line without derivative coming out of this vertex, or line without derivative coming out of this vertex.
Why cannot connect to that?
Because that will be a different diagram. That will be a diagram like this, right? Because you don't have the derivative acting on the line 1. See, phi or delta j, that this line 1 connects to has no derivative. Right? That's the meaning of these crosses. Right? Associated with this diagram, right? This diagram represents when line 1 connects to a particular line in the vortex which has no derivative. Right? So line 1 can connect only 2 of them. Either from the first vortex, the one without derivative from the first vortex, or one without derivative from the second vortex. Right? These will be counted as different diagrams. So if it had connected to some line with derivatives, right, that would be like a diagram like this. You have to draw it as a different diagram. For example, let's take these two, the same.
These lines which we connect from the external point to the vertex.
Yes.
We draw that later. I mean, from the beginning we don't draw line connecting the external point to vertex?
No, from beginning we don't draw it, but when you draw Feynman diagrams, right, what does the Feynman diagram mean? That we have these various delta j's for each external line. Okay. Then you have from the vertices, S interaction factors. These again have my delta j's, and then you have the propagator, which is the exponential of I times this. Okay, this has a quadratic expression with j. Now, this delta j tilde minus k1, and one of delta j tildes from here will act on a particular factor in the exponential. Okay, so if we expand out the exponential, you get this sum over n, 1 over n factorial jj to the power n. Okay. Now that Feynman diagram keeps track of which line here and which line here act on the same J, same JJ combination. Okay? That's where the propagator is coming from. So if you take a delta delta J from here, which has no derivative, right, that can possibly pair with this one. Right? But if you take a delta delta J which has a derivative, that cannot pair with this one as far as this diagram is concerned. Is that clear? That's why this one can pair with only two of these six lines. So once you have made that choice, then two can pair with two of them, right? Because two of the lines have derivatives, right? So one has already connected to one, so two can connect to any of the other two. And similarly, you count three, right? Three can now connect only one of them, right? Because this has already connected, so there is only one line without derivative left over. That's why the three must connect. Four can still connect to any two. And then the others connect to each other. Okay, that's the way you'll count the common trait factor. Yeah, and you should be able to verify that after you do this counting, okay, and you add up the contribution from all the Feynman diagrams that come here, okay, you should reproduce the result that you would have gotten by doing the calculus in the other way. Is that clear?
In connection to the differential operator.
Yes.
So, what if we do everything in position space and apply it in curve space time?
Yes, you can do it in position space.
Then we shouldn't be worried about the momentum conservation.
The point is, even if you're in momentum space, you need not worry about momentum conservation, right? It's just that you have to allow for momentum non-conservation, right? But then the question is, how easy will it be to calculate the Green's function? In position space, you have to calculate the position space Green's function in that background. Right? That is, in general, need not be easy. Right? You put an arbitrary card space. Okay, but in principle, this is the philosophy. As long as you are not trying to quantize the space-time itself, as long as you are not trying to quantize the metric, okay, you think of that as a fixed background, okay, and you quantize a quantum field theory in that background by following the same procedure.
Say the momentum is not conserved, the extra energy or extra part is going into the information of the metric.
Yeah, except that, I mean, here, because the metric is not a dynamical field, you don't see that,
yes,
right? It's like, you don't have to consider curved space, right? You can take a fixed electromagnetic background, right? And consider scattering from the fixed electromagnetic background. It's the same philosophy, right? You formulate the action in that background, okay? Say, a Dirac equation in a fixed electromagnetic background. And you can calculate the propagator, except that that will no longer conserve momentum. Is this clear? Any other question? Okay. So yesterday I wrote down a general formalism. So what we'll do today is to apply it to a specific case where it in fact doesn't work. Okay, but we'll see why it doesn't work, and then later on we'll try to fix it. Okay. So scalar field, of course, is the simplest one, but let's now consider the Maxwell action. Okay, and see what kind of action you get in a momentum space. So this is given by -1/4 integral d4x. So if we now write it in a momentum space, we can write this as minus I k mu, a tilde mu of minus k plus I k mu Okay, I have skipped some steps, but this is straightforward. You have to write each mu in the Fourier expansion. So you have to use a mu of x as integral d4k you substitute for both mu's in that Fourier expansion. Then when you apply the derivatives, it will bring down factors of ik mu. Okay, and then you carry out the x integral in that process, picking up a delta function in momentum. Okay, that's the reason why it's minus k and k. Okay, again, this is a reflection of momentum conservation. Okay, but this is just, in this analysis, it will just come from the x integral. The x integral will automatically give you a delta function, which tells us the sum of the momentum of the first one and the second one must vanish. Will there be minus? Yes?
Yeah.
Because see, this a nu comes with argument k,
yes,
right? So that's e to the I k dot x, right? That's why it's, the derivative is bringing on I k mu.
Yeah, no, but in the first term there is a minus.
This is minus. I put a minus I k mu,
right?
In the second term there is a minus here that I made it plus. Yeah, so there is a relative minus sign. See, there is always a relative minus sign between the first and the second term, right? This gives you I k mu, right? And this one gives you I k nu, right? And this minus sign is just this minus sign. Yeah, between the first and the second term, there is a minus sign. Here also you can see that between the first and the second term, this is minus, this is plus.
Okay.
Is that okay? So this one, after some manipulation, we can write as half. But this is telling you by to the fourth guy. Is this,
yeah?
D4x. Here is D4x.
That is also.
It becomes D4k after the Fourier transform. So this is our m. So this, if you compare with what we did earlier, mk mu nu is minus k squared beta mu nu plus k mu. Okay, yesterday we wrote it as general mkij phi tilde I phi tilde j. Right? So if we just compare with this, our mk for this particular example is this matrix. Is this clear? This is just by comparing with what we did yesterday. Okay, yesterday let me just remind you what it worked. Load the action as half integral d4k over 2 pi to the 4 pi I think we call it pi l of minus k mk l l prime phi l prime of k. this was the general form we wrote. Right? Today the roles of phi are being played by A's. So this is our matrix. But this matrix is not invertible. Okay, because the next step yesterday was to invert phi, invert M. Right? That's what gave the propagator. But this matrix, you can convince yourself, is not invertible. So MK mu nu, MK is not invertible here. Yeah? Pardon?
This will be singular if we use k square equals to 0 or?
No, in general. If the matrix is not invertible for some particular value of k, okay, it doesn't matter because that just means that the propagator will have a pole at that value of k. Okay? The problem comes if the matrix is not invertible for any value of k. Is that clear? Because even k square plus m square, right, which is the standard scalar field value for m, that also is not invertible when k square plus m square is 0.
Sir, you are telling this because there exist eigenvalue, suppose k eigenvector, suppose k nu, and that actually gives the 0 eigenvalue.
So in this case, you can see that for general k, it is not invertible. Okay. And that's because there is a 0 eigenvector, okay, an eigenvector, 0 eigenvalue for all k. Okay. So if you take mk mu nu times k nu, this is minus k square eta mu nu plus k mu k nu times k nu, okay, so which is 0 identical. Okay, without imposing any condition on k.
This for all k.
This for all k. Okay. So because it's 0 for all k, you just cannot define the propagator. Okay, so this is important to keep in mind that we don't worry about matrix if the matrix is not invertible for some particular values of k. Okay, because that just means that the propagator will have poles. Okay, just like 1 over k square plus m square has a pole at k square plus m square equal to 0. Okay. But this is a much more serious problem because this shows that we cannot even define the propagator, right, for any k. Okay. So this is the kind of problem we will be dealing with later, okay, because this is generally this happens whenever there is a gauge symmetry. Okay. This is related to the fact that the action is invariant, okay, related to A mu going to A mu plus del mu lambda symmetry. Okay, because A mu goes to A mu plus del mu lambda, okay, in the momentum space becomes A tilde mu goes to A tilde mu plus I k mu lambda tilde. Right? Which basically means that if you shift A mu by something proportional to I k mu, it doesn't change the action. And that means that I k mu must be a 0 eigenvector, an eigenvector or 0 eigenvalue, right? Because the matrix, the quadratic form doesn't change when you change this A tilde mu by I k mu. Right? That's what this is saying.
Sir,
so,
is this related to
also
the massless, because it's massless?
No, it's not related to the fact that it's massless. Because you can consider massless scalars, for example, right? Phi tilde k square phi tilde. Right? That's perfectly okay. 1 over k square is a well-defined quantity as long as k square is not 0. Okay. So the problem is not because it's massless. Right? The problem is that there is a symmetry, okay, local symmetry of this kind, okay, which requires that the final action that you get must have a flat direction. Right? That when you change A tilde mu by anything proportional to k mu, okay, the action simply doesn't change. Is this point clear? Okay. So this is of course the source of the problem. Okay, how we solve it we will see later. Okay, so right now you should just keep in mind that the formalism that I described yesterday is going to be valid, okay, as given only in cases where mk is invertible, okay, and there are cases when mk is not invertible, okay, which you have to deal with carefully.
absenteeism in invariant under this local symmetry.
Yes.
So how it is reflected in this M matrix?
Okay. So let me write it here. So I have not erased it. So this is our action, right? So the action was, let's say that, integral d4k over 2 pi to the 4 a tilde mu minus k mk mu nu a tilde nu of k. Okay. Now, this symmetry of the action means that this is unchanged. Under a tilde mu right. So then you take this action and make this change. If you make this change, you see that the change will be proportional to mk mu nu k nu. Lambda tilde is completely arbitrary. Right? But you know that the action shouldn't change. Right? That means that the mk mu nu k nu must vanish. Right? So that's the general argument. Okay, so whenever there is a gauge symmetry, you can expect that the kinetic term will have zero eigenvalues, zero. Okay, and hence it's not invertible. Is this clear? Okay, so I'll leave this for now. Okay, later on, as I said, we'll come back and see how to fix it. And then we'll turn to fermions. Okay, because so far whatever I have done is valid for bosonic fields, okay, but fermions you have to be more careful. So let me just remind you that in the canonical formalism, the fermion fields have anti-commutation relation instead of commutation relation. And psi hat alpha xt with psi hat beta dagger yt is delta alpha beta. That is an H bar delta. Delta q, sorry. Okay, I have put back the h back for now, okay, because we want to see what happens in the classical limit. Is this okay? Is this familiar? Yeah. Pardon? Well, okay, it depends on what action you take. You can put an I here. Okay, but in fact, I think here there is no I, because you see, if you take the Hermitian conjugate of this, right, it will give you psi hat beta, psi hat alpha dagger, right?
So this is symmetric, right? So there's no I here. Okay, and that's because in the Dirac axis, the psi dagger is I times the conjugate momentum. Because you have I psi dagger del t psi, right? So psi dagger is a, not the conjugate momentum, but I times the conjugate momentum. That's why there's no I over here. Okay. Now, as far as these relations are concerned, and if you work in the quantum theory and think of these as operator relations, okay, these are perfectly sensible. Right? Operators can have any relations. Okay, these are just relations imposed on the operators. Okay. The problem comes if you try to interpret this in the classical limit. So suppose you take the h bar goes to zero limit. Then these are all zero. Okay. But even in this case, you cannot think of these as classical fields, right? Because classical fields always commute, right? There is no sense in which product of two classical fields is changes sign when you interchange them, right? So in this sense, the fermionic field theory, okay, has really no classical limit, okay? You can try to define classical limit, but that's only a formal construction, okay? There is no real classical limit. For example, there is no sense in which you can try to write down a classical solution to the equations of motion, okay, to the full nonlinear equations of motion, right? It really doesn't make sense. Okay. Nevertheless, you can think of this as a formal construction, and that's what we'll try to do. Okay. The reason that we are interested in classical limit, okay, or at least some form of classical limit, is because in the path integral approach, we have a classical action, right? We integrate over the fields, okay, but weighted by e to the is, which is a classical action. Okay. But now we are saying that there is really no classical limit of this theory, right? So then what is the meaning of classical action? Okay, classical action is not a number, right? Because these are certainly not numbers. These don't become standard numbers in the classical limit. Okay, so we have to learn. We need to formulate rules for path integral over formula fields. And you should keep in mind that these are really rules. Okay, that these are the some we will use some definitions. Okay. Using those definitions, we will define what we mean by path integral over fermion fields. Okay, you shouldn't think of these as ordinary integrals. Okay, but using these rules, after you carry out the integral, what you generate are numbers. Okay, because after all, the correlation functions that you are looking for, right? Expectation value of product of operators, those are ordinary numbers. Right. So whatever be the rules. Okay, it must be that after you carry out these rules, okay, after you use these rules and evaluate that is necessary path integral, the final quantity should be a number. Okay, so we'll now try to develop these rules, and then we'll see how these rules lead to correctly the fermionic correlation functions. Okay, and when I say it leads correctly to the fermionic correlation functions, okay, I mean precisely that these are the fermionic correlation functions that we would have calculated otherwise from the canonical formalism. Okay. Because at this level, we are trying to set up a formalism, okay, which we'll call formalic path integral. Okay. But the goal is that this formalism should give the same result as the canonical formalism in the known cases. Right. And then we'll use this formalism to generalize the construction where the standard canonical formalism is not easy to apply. Okay. But at least where standard canonical formalism is easy to apply, these rules better give the same results as a standard canonical formalism, right? So that will be our testing principle, okay, that we have got the correct rules. Okay. So now we'll forget about field theory for a while and just try to develop some rules for Grassmann numbers. Thank you. So introduce what we call Grassmann variables. Okay, these are abstract quantities. Okay, these are, again, let me emphasize, these are not ordinary numbers. Theta 1 to theta n. Okay. And let me just say that what these will stand for eventually when you apply it to path integral. Either these will eventually represent this set of numbers psi alpha. And then when you discretize, you will have i0, i1, i2, i3. Right? These are the discretized version of space time. And psi dagger alpha i0. Okay, or you can also write it in the momentum space. Okay, so these thetas that I am introducing here will eventually stand for these objects. Is this clear? Okay, or they could stand for the conjugate currents that we will be introducing. Okay, those will be also analogs of some thetas. But right now, I'll just think of these thetas as abstract variables and try to develop some rules. So first, we'll define
that each Grassmann variable is an anti-commutator or just the product of the sine psi dagger?
No, not product. This is comma. What I mean is that eventually this set of theta 1 to theta n will represent the set of psi's as well as set of psi daggers. Okay, it's not an anti-commutator. This is just the collection of all these is what will be represented by theta 1, theta 2, theta n. Okay, but right now we will not talk about the psi's and psi daggers. We'll just work with the thetas as an abstract object. Okay. So first definition is that of a product. Given two such thetas, we can take a product. Okay. This is again an abstract object, theta 1, theta 2. But these products are not all independent. We have a relation, and the relation is that theta 1, theta 2 will be minus theta 2, theta 1. Or let me write as theta I, theta j is minus theta j, theta I.
There would be corresponding psi and psi dagger. This is what
you are saying? No. What I mean is that the set of thetas, right, will correspond to the set of these. That eventually we will not have the thetas, right? We will have these. Right? But the rules of integration over these will be what will give us the rules of integration over the thetas. So the n here, okay, n here will stand for the total number of these variables. Right? That's what I mean by saying that eventually each of these will correspond to a theta.
Any of these thetas can correspond to psi or psi dagger?
Yes, that some of the thetas will correspond to psi, some of them will correspond to psi dagger. Is that okay? So right now I am thinking of these are real, right? So you can think of this as one, some of the thetas will correspond to psi plus psi dagger, some of them will correspond to psi minus psi dagger by I. Okay, even later on we will also deal with complex Grassmann numbers. Okay, so this is the rule for product. Okay, otherwise these are independent. Theta 1, theta 2, for example, has nothing to do with theta 2, theta 3. They are independent objects. So then, definition, a function. A function of theta 1 to theta n is a function. This one is defined by its Taylor series expansion.
It's true even when I equals j, right?
Yes, so when I is equal to j, it will be 0. Right? Because theta I square is minus theta I square. Right? That means theta I square must be 0. Okay, so this implies that theta I square is 0. Is this clear? Theta I square is minus theta I square. Okay. So, again, this Taylor series expansion at this stage is formal. Okay, so I will put it in quotes. So if theta 1 to theta n is given by a 0 plus sum over I equal to 1 to n a 1 I theta I, I less than j. Or let me just keep it like this. Okay, half. Well, we'll choose the A k, I1 to ik is totally antisymmetric. Okay, so in particular here, for example, A2, 1, 2, theta 1, theta 2. And a 2 2 1 theta 2 theta 1. Okay, but since theta 2 theta 1 is minus theta 1 theta 2, right, I could take a 2 2 1 to be minus a 2 1. Is that clear? If there is a symmetric part, it will just drop out. Okay, so I can choose a's to be fully antisymmetric. So these a's are just ordinary numbers. So let's count how many independent a's there are. There is one a0. So number of independent ans, number of independent coefficients. 1 a 0, right? How many a1i's? N a1i's. How many a2's? So nc2, right? Because twist, anti-symmetric combination you are picking up. So nc2 up to ncn. Right? The last one is fully anti-symmetric, right? So there is really one choice. Right? Once you fix 1, 2 to n, everything else gets fixed. So that's 2 to the n. This is 1 plus 1 to the n. This is 2 to the n. Okay, so then if you have a, so this is what is called Grassmann algebra. If you have a Grassmann algebra with n variables, then a function is specified by specifying 2 to the n coefficients, 2 to the n constants. Okay. So this is different from the function of a real variable, right, which requires infinite number of constants. If you have a function of even a single real variable, right, you can Taylor series expand and try to define the function in terms of Taylor series expansion coefficients, but you need infinite number of coefficients. Right? Whereas a function of n Grassmann variables really only need 2 to the n coefficients. Is this clear? So a function, again this is definition, if is even if ak I1 to ik is 0 for odd k. And if is odd, if this is equal to 0 for even k. This k runs from?
I mean, this totally anti-symmetric property holds for all the k.
Yes, exactly. So, in fact, even for 1, for 1 of course it's trivial. Okay, it is for any k. So, this is the definition of what is an even function, what is an odd function. Okay. Even function contains only those terms which have even number of thetas in the product. Odd functions contain only those terms which have odd number of thetas in the product. Is clear? And given any function, you can always write it as a sum of an even function and an even odd function. Okay. You just decompose the function as a sum of two terms, one containing only the even parts of theta, the other containing only odd parts of theta. Here is the result. Okay, this is not an assumption, this is what follows from what I have already said, which is that fg, these are two functions, is equal to gf if either f or g is even and fg equal to minus gf if both f and g are odd. Is this obvious? Yeah, I think if I give some examples, so for example theta 1 times theta 2 theta 3. This is supposed to be the same as theta 2 theta 3. And theta 1. Is that obvious? You write theta 1, theta 2 as minus theta 2, theta 1, and then theta 1, theta 3 as minus theta 3, theta 1. So 2 minus signs make it plus, so it becomes theta 2, theta 3 times theta 1. So these are the case of an odd function times an even function. Okay? So odd function times even function, okay, will be all in this class. Okay, similarly, even you can also check false in this class. Odd, okay, theta 1, theta 2 is minus theta 2, theta 1. That's the simplest example. But you can easily verify that if you have any number of odd parts, okay, say theta 1, theta 2, theta 3, times theta 4, theta 5, theta 6. This is minus theta 4, theta 5, theta 6, times theta 1, theta 2. Okay, you basically have to take one by one. Theta 3, you take theta 3 first, you pass it through this, pass through this, and pass it through this, right? You become a net minus sign because there are three minus signs. Then you do for theta 2, okay, again you pass it one by one, okay, you pick up three minus signs. And for this, you pick up three minus signs, so that's nine minus signs altogether, right? So which gives you minus one. Okay, that's this minus sign. Try again some definition. Of derivative. Okay. So why do we need definition of derivative? Okay. We need the definition of derivative because eventually we will be taking functional derivatives of some generating function to calculate the correlation. Normally the functional derivative is taken with respect to those currents, those j's, right? In this case, those j's will also be formal Grassmann numbers, right? Because psi's are Grassmann numbers, j's will also have to be Grassmann numbers. Okay? So you need to know how to take derivative with respect to Grassmann numbers. Okay? And again, this is not that is derived from somewhere, okay? This is just a definition. Okay? We will follow these definitions and we will see at the end that we get a consistent set of rules. So the definition of derivative, okay, is given as follows. Del del theta I of theta j is delta ij. And del del theta I of f times j is del f del theta I times g plus minus 1 to the f . So this is a symbol minus 1 to the f . This by definition is 1 if f is even and minus 1 if f is odd. Pardon?
F after the del g del theta.
Oh yes, del g. Well, f times this, not after, f is on the left, yeah. Is this definition clear? Right? This is a definition, this is also a definition, right? This is telling you how to apply del del theta on a single theta. That doesn't tell you how to apply del del theta on an arbitrary function of theta. The second one, combined with the first one, tells you how to apply del del theta on an arbitrary function of theta. So for example, suppose you want to calculate del del theta 1 of theta 1, theta 2, theta 3. To do this, you have to first apply this. Okay, it's a product of functions. So this is del del theta 1 of theta 1 times theta 2, theta 3 plus theta 1 times del del theta 1, sorry, minus theta 2 theta 3. Okay? This gives you theta 2 theta 3. This again has to be calculated by applying the same rule again. So this should be del theta 2 del theta 1 times theta 3 minus theta 2 times del theta 3 del theta 1. But these are of course 0, by the first rule. So these are all 0. So you are left with this term, which is theta through theta. Is this clear? Okay. So the point is that once I give these two as part of the definition of the derivative, then you can calculate the derivative of any function that you like. Okay, because every function has expansion in terms of sum of products of the theta is. Yes.
This question, because you said that later we interpret this theta as this size and size error. So there we saw that also in the anti-commutation relation for canonical formulas, when in the action also there is size we assume as functions of x, right? Then mu shy appears.
Yeah, so we'll again, everything will be formal, right? We have not said now how we are going to write down an action, right? The action will also be a formal function in this sense, right? Just the way you thought of function as just a formal expansion in terms of Grassmann variables, right? The action also has to be thought of that way, right? As a formal expansion in the psi alphas, then the coefficients of expansion are ordinary numbers, okay? But the expansion will be in terms of these abstract variable psi. Is this clear? Okay. So you have to distinguish between what are actual numbers, okay, which are these coefficients of expansion, okay, and what are formal variables, the thetas in this case, okay, and any physical quantity, okay, that will eventually compare with an experiment, okay, cannot involve these thetas, okay, because thetas are abstract numbers, though they don't give you something that you can measure. Okay. So all the physical quantities at the end must involve only the a's that I am introducing. Okay, those are the standard numbers.
Sir, division is not defined in this formula, right?
No, we are not dividing, though. Okay, the division is defined only in the sense that you have to, if you take 1 over g, right, you have a Taylor series expand, and then define. Use that. Okay, I'll discuss some examples. So based on this definition, so you now prove another result. Which is the del del theta I of del del theta j of f is minus del del theta j for any function. But I should have said here that if f is neither even nor odd, right, then of course minus 1 to the f is not defined. Right? So what you have to do in that case is that you have to write f as a sum of odd plus even. Right? So you have to write f as f odd plus f even. And write this as del del theta I of f even times g plus del del theta I of f odd times g, and then apply this formula. Is that clear? Okay, so f need not be either purely even or purely odd, but if it's not purely even or purely odd, you have to first decompose it and then apply this formula on individual terms, okay, on f odd times g and f even times g separately, because it's minus 1 to the f, of course, will differ whether it's odd function or even function.
F are the products of thetas.
Yes, F involves products of theta, sum of products of thetas. Right? But F could be, for example, A plus B theta. A plus B theta 1, right? Which is neither even nor odd.
right? So what you will do is that you will treat A as separately, okay, and B theta term separately. Okay. For the A, you will use minus 1 to the F equal to 1. Okay. For B theta 1, you will use minus 1 to the F equal to minus 1 while applying this formula, right? And then you sum them up.
Zero
A constant, yes, we call constant has zero number of thetas, right? Exactly. That will treat it as even. Is this okay?
Sir?
Yes.
I mean, Taylor series expansion in what sense? I mean, how to find A's? I mean,
So I'll describe what you mean by Taylor series expansion, right? I'll give some examples. For example, if you want to define sine of something or cosine of something,
yes.
Right? I mean, yeah, I'll explain how to define those. Okay, so let's try to prove this. Okay, so to prove this, we'll divide this set theta into two parts. Okay, so we'll divide theta 1 to theta n. Into that is theta 1, theta 2, sorry, theta I, theta j, and the set theta 1 to theta I minus 1, theta I plus 1 to theta j minus 1, theta j plus 1 to theta I. Okay, because we are taking derivatives of theta I and theta j, I can just divide into these two sets. Okay, this I'll call theta prime. Okay, so when I say something is a function of theta prime, okay, I'll mean that this has a Taylor series expansion, okay, in these thetas. Okay, not in theta I and theta j. Is that point clear? Yeah. So we have the whole set theta 1 to theta n, right? I'm just dividing it into two parts. One part involves just theta I and theta j, and then the rest. This rest I'm collectively calling theta prime. Okay. So if I write a function of theta prime, right, that means that function has a Taylor series expansion only in these variables. Okay, not in theta I or theta j.
But
differences
are coming for theta.
Pardon?
Ij.
No. So theta I minus 1, okay, this set involves up to theta I minus 1, then theta I plus 1. Theta I is missing from this set.
The first term in the bracket is what?
Theta 1. Is theta 1 up to theta I minus 1, then theta I plus 1, and theta j minus 1, theta j plus 1 to theta n. So then, any function f will have the following expansion: a theta prime plus theta I b theta prime plus theta j c theta prime plus theta I theta j d theta. Theta prime means that A theta prime, this is a function of all the thetas except theta I and theta j. Is this clear? So let's just make sure that you have got the full set of coefficients. Right? So a function of theta prime, how many coefficients does it have? How many independent coefficients? 2 to the power n minus 2, right? Because there are n minus 2 variables, right? So there are 2 to the power n minus 2 coefficients here, 2 to the power n minus 2 here, right? 2 to the n minus 2 here, and 2 to the n minus 2 here.
That gives you 4 times 2 to the n minus 2, which is precisely 2 to the n. 4 times 2 to the n minus 2 is 2 to the n, right? Okay. So, collectively, these 4 have exactly the same amount of coefficients, same number of coefficients as the original function, right? So, you have not lost anything. You have just reorganized our expansion in this way. Okay. So, now let's calculate the left hand side and the right hand side and see what we get. So, first, del del theta j of f. From here, we get c theta prime. We take derivative with respect to theta j. Then del del theta j of c theta prime is 0. Here, del del theta j of theta I, of course, is 0. Okay, I and j are different. Then we pass it through, become a minus sign. Del del theta j of theta j gives you 1. So that gives you minus theta I times d theta prime. Is that clear? I just take the took the derivative of this, right? This minus sign came because del del theta j has to pass through this theta I. So now del del theta I of this j of f.
So is that j with c?
Yeah.
J with c, yes. J with c. So del del theta I, del del theta j of f. We are taking del del theta I of this. So this gives you 0. This has no theta I. This has a theta I, so that gives you minus d theta prime. Now let's do the other way. Del del theta I of f. That's d theta prime. Because this time there is a minus sign because theta I is on the left. So theta j times d theta prime. So del del theta j del del theta I of f is minus, sorry, is just d theta prime. Okay, and we see indeed that these are opposite. There's a minus sign there. Okay, so there is a minus sign if you compare. And that proves this relation. No, you could write it in many different ways, right?
Yes.
But after all, it's the same f,
yes.
Right? So you can take the derivative. I mean, you should get the same result irrespective of how you write it, right?
Any term of f will never contain more than one theta I.
Yes.
So del del theta I of f is 0 and you work back to the logic that that will...
Yeah, del del theta I of f of course is 0.
Yes.
But del del theta j of f is what we are looking for, right? So this, from this it follows that del del theta I of f is 0. Right? But that's just a consequence of the fact that any term in f cannot have more than one theta I.
Yes.
Yes.
So I was saying that the way we work that from that definition theta j is also minus theta j theta I from that. We showed that theta is equal to 0.
Yes.
So from here, can we just work back the logic that way? Say
that will say that del del theta I square is 0, right? But the other way we didn't prove, right? From theta I square equal to 0, we didn't prove that theta j is equal to minus theta j theta I. Right? I mean, of course, if you, assume that any linear combination of the theta I have squares to 0, that is equivalent to saying that theta j is minus theta j theta I. Right? But that's not what you are saying here.
theta j
theta i.
Minus theta j theta i.
Yes.
So, in the denominator, if they are, then can't we use that relation?
No, that's the point. That this is not derivative with respect to theta i. Right? Because theta i's are not normal numbers. Okay? Del del theta i has been defined by these relations. Okay, I wrote down two relations. Okay? It's a formal operation that defines del del theta i. So you cannot use the standard notation of theta I being in the denominator, hence they must anti-commute, right? I mean, you shouldn't think of it that way because these are not normal numbers, right? And that's why you have to be careful because sometimes you may make mistakes if you try to use similar intuition, okay? And we'll see some cases where you can make such mistakes, right? If you just use intuitively that del del theta is like theta in the denominator. Okay, so this is the formal proof that indeed del del theta and del del theta is anti-commute. This is okay? Any other question?
Sir, what about other means? If you take derivatives with greater number of thetas, let's say del theta i, who can derive those things?
Yeah, that of course will follow from here. Okay? Once you have proved a relation like this, then multiple del del theta, you can just use this relation repeatedly, right? And work out how it will look, right? As you commute them to each other. Okay, now let me define what we have been referring to, that formal function. So suppose f of x is an ordinary function. Okay, of a real variable x. And let's suppose that it has a Taylor series expansion. So, examples are sine x, cosine x, right? 1 over x is not on this category, right? Because that doesn't have a Taylor series expansion, but 1 over x plus a constant is in that category, right? 1 over x plus c can be expanded in Taylor series in power of x. Suppose you have a Taylor series expansion like this, and then suppose g of theta is a function of Grassmann variables theta 1 to theta n. This is in the sense that I described. Okay, this has this Taylor series expansion in theta i with the coefficients being ordinary numbers. Then I'll define f of g of theta as sum over n fn g of theta g over n.
That will be the definition of f of theta. So you expand f first in the Taylor series expansion, and then substitute for each, for this x is this g of theta.
G of theta is also Grassmann. What is G of theta?
G of theta is could be Grassmann even or Grassmann odd, or could be a combination of Grassmann even and Grassmann odd. Okay. For example, G of theta could be theta 1.
Yes.
Right. In which case, this will be like fn theta 1 to the power n. Right. Which basically means it will be just f0 plus f1 times theta 1. Okay. Because theta 1 square will be 0.
In that case, we are departing from our original assumption that f is a function of real value, because now f is no longer a function of real value, right?
Which f? Oh, no. So this is the definition. So f is a function of real variables, which basically means that I have a Taylor series expansion of the form fn x to the n, where fn's are ordinary numbers. Now, given this function, right, now I am defining
only by the analogy, and because
not by analogy. This is my definition. See, when I give define, right, I can define it any way you like, right? The definition of f of g of theta will be that you take the Taylor series expansion of f of x and replace x by g of theta in the Taylor series expansion. Right? I mean, for a definition, you can only, argue whether the definition is well defined or not, right? Whether I have defined something which is ambiguous, right? This object here is unambiguous, right? Fn's are ordinary numbers. G of theta, right, has a Taylor series expansion, okay, and we know how to multiply two g's, right? Okay, if it's a sum of products of thetas, we just multiply them, right, using the rules of theta 1, theta I square is 0, and theta I theta j is minus theta j theta I. So right hand side is a well defined object given f of x, which has a well defined Taylor series expansion. But 1 over g of theta, for example, will not be defined.
Sir, so the definition is like that if this is the same coefficient as fx.
Yes, this fn's. Otherwise, of course, why are you calling f, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Fn's are the same fn's which appear here. Okay, so let's do some examples. Sine theta 1. What is it? So theta 1, okay, sine of x, what Taylor series expansion does it have? X minus x cube by 3 factorial and so on, right?
G of theta minus.
See, g, you cannot write g anymore. Sine of g is theta 1, right? So what is it? So this is definite expansion, right? It's theta 1, because sine of x is x minus x cube over 3 factorial plus x to the 5 over 5 factorial and so on, right? And you have substitute for x theta 1, right? So first term is the only one which survives, right? Because x cube gives theta 1 cube, which is 0. So this is theta 1. Sine of theta 1, theta 2. Theta 1, theta 2. Right? Because theta 1, theta 2 square cube will again be 0, right? Theta 1 cube is 0. Sine of theta 1 plus theta 2.
Theta 1 minus 2 theta 1 theta 2.
Well, start from the first term. What is the first term? Theta 1 plus theta 2, right? Theta 1 plus theta 2. Anything else?
No.
See, 1 over 3 factorial, theta 1 plus theta 2 cube, right? Yeah, this is 0. This is 0 for several reasons. First of all, of course, you have theta 1 and theta 2, right? So every term will have to have at least 2 theta 1s or 2 theta 2s, right? But there is something more to it, even theta 1 plus theta 2 square. How much is this?
That is theta 1 plus theta 2 square is theta 1 plus theta 2
times theta 1 plus theta 2, right? It's 0 because theta 1 square is 0, theta 2 square is 0, right? But these two will cancel each other. So this is also 0. Okay, so this way you can define exponential, cosines and various things. Okay, and again this is important because eventually if you recall, I had this z of j, right? Z of j was exponentials of the quadratic form in j. Okay. So if we land up with something similar, and if j is a Grassmann valued object, right, j's will be the analogs of thetas. Okay, both size and j's will be like the thetas. Right? We have to know what it means, right? What is exponential of I times j, right? And what it means is this, that you first do a series expansion of the exponential, right? And then in each term in the series expansion, you substitute that I times j times j. Okay, that's what this thing is saying.
Sir?
Yes?
In defining these operations, whatever rules you proposed,
yes?
The notion of a zero, was it clear actually in the rules that you had already given, like the multiplication by zero or an addition to a zero?
Yeah, so zero, okay, zero is an ordinary number. The ordinary numbers are also part of the their expansion, right? So when I said minus theta 1, you should have asked me, right? What is the meaning of minus theta 1? Right? So minus theta 1 means that the notion of 0 is already there, right? Because when you add theta 1 to minus theta 1, right, that's, you should get a 0. Right? So 0 has a standard property that when you take the product of 0 with anything, it is 0. Okay? I didn't say this explicitly, but when you take the product of two terms, right, the standard distribution, right, a plus b times c plus d, okay, is ac plus ad plus bc plus bd. That is still true. Right?
Minus theta is minus 1 times theta basically, right? That's what, how minus theta.
Yes, minus 1 times theta 1, exactly. Right. So when you add two of them, right, 1 plus theta 1 is plus minus theta 1, right, you'll get 1 minus 1 times theta 1. Right? And 1 minus 1 is 0. And we'll use the fact that a product of 0 with anything is 0. Okay. So, more generally, you can think of that anything, that any relation that holds among matrices, you can take to be holding for the thetas.
Yeah, because this is kind of a new number field you are defining, so the operation on 0 has to end.
Yeah, so if you think of the thetas as operators, right? So, let me say this, I have specified some properties of the thetas. Some others which are more obvious I have not specified. Okay. So any relation that holds for matrices is true for thetas. Okay. So for the matrices A plus B times C plus D. Okay. A plus B times C plus D. Is AC plus AD plus BC plus BD. So, as far as algebra is concerned, this is a matrix relation. Okay? And this relation you can also assume to be true for functions of Grassmann variables. Yeah, so to take the f plus g times f tilde.
This is 0 of this number field, it works like the 0 of the real field.
0 of the matrix field. I mean, again, 0 in a matrix operation, right, is well defined, right? 0 times a matrix is 0, a matrix with 0 is everywhere, right? So, 0 is something whose product with anything gives you 0. Okay, and when you add 0 to something, you get rather the same number. Is this okay? So, as far as the algebra of the Grassmann functions are concerned, you can assume that any relation that holds for matrices also holds for this. Okay, there are some additional relations that I am specifying, which not always hold for matrices, right? So only those are the ones I'm writing explicitly. Like theta I, theta j equal to minus theta j, theta I, will not hold for any matrix, right? So that's something I'm writing explicitly. Okay. But theta I plus theta j times theta k, right? Theta I plus theta j times theta k, right? I mean, if you are careful, you would have asked me how to write this, how to relate this to theta I theta k, plus theta j theta k, right? I mean, is this true or not? Okay, I didn't say explicitly that this is true, but because this holds for matrices, that we assume that this is true. Is this clear? Okay, so it is understood that all properties of matrices are also valid for Grassmann valid functions. Okay, so the additional properties that I am describing here, okay, like this anti-commutation or the derivatives, right? It doesn't make sense to take the derivative with respect to a matrix. Okay? That's an extra structure that we have introduced, right? Derivative with respect to theta is. Is this clear? Yeah. Are there other questions?
Yeah. Yes. Just when you started defining the set theta 1 to theta n,
yes.
So there in that set was 0 included or
not? No, thetas were the generators of the Grassmann algebra
exactly.
Numbers, right?
So zero
but 0 is included in the part of the expansion coefficient.
Yes.
Right? So that's where 0 is included, right? So you think of this theta 1 to theta n, okay, as abstract matrices, okay? And then anything that you can do with the matrix algebra, you perform on the product of the thetas, right? You can add them, you can take the products, okay? But there are additional structures in these thetas, which I am specifying, okay? Like theta I, theta j being equal to minus theta j, theta I, okay? Or the ability to take derivative with respect to theta is, right, which are not there in a general matrix algebra, right? So those are the ones I am writing not explicitly. Is this okay?
So 0 is additive identity, that's it.
Yeah, so 0 is like a 0 matrix, right? If you add 0 to your matrix, you get the same matrix back. If you look at a product of a matrix with 0, you get back 0 matrix.
So, when you initialize the matrix, take n number of Grassmann variables.
Yes.
Is they are independent? Means,
yes, you treat them as independent, right? Except that there is this relation that theta I theta j is minus theta j theta I.
So, can we initially take n number of Grassmann variables? Can we increase the number of Grassmann variables starting of n number of Grassmann variables? Can create n plus 1 number of Grassmann variables out of the independent or is
only not independent? They will not call them independent, right? You can of course construct other Grassmann variables like theta starting from theta 1 and theta 2, you can construct theta 1, theta 2, theta 3, right? Which will anti-commute with all the theta is.
Yes.
Okay.
But
it's not independent.
So if we initially start with n number of Grassmann variables, it will remain n number of Grassmann variables.
Exactly, right? So the best is that initially itself you introduce all the Grassmann variables that you need, right? And think of the manipulation that you are doing is a manipulation in the algebra of those Grassmann variables, right? So for example, when we deal with quantum field theories, we'll think of the theta i's as corresponding to all the psi's, okay, as well as all the j's, okay, which are conjugate to psi's, and all our manipulations will be done in that space.
So it is closed under that?
Yeah, then of course it will be closed, right? I mean, if you take the products of psi's and j's or derivative with respect to j's, everything will be in that space only. Is this okay? Any other questions?
So in the action, we will also have the sort of space-time derivatives of the Grassmann fields entering.
Yes.
So they have to be always interpreted in terms of some discrete counterpart or?
Yeah, those will be like the psi I0. I1 psi I0 plus 1 I1 I2 I3 minus psi I0 I1 I2 I3 divided by 1 over delta. This is the time derivative, right?
Sure. But for actual real valued fields, you could have interpreted a limit, sort of. When you
here these are formal.
Here
right? But the point is, even though these are formal, right, you never really have to go back to the discrete formulation once you learn how to deal with these Grassmann variables, right? Because you'll have to basically learn the trick of functional differentiation, right? Which will be the ordinary derivative but with some things added in, right? I have already defined ordinary derivatives for Grassmann variables, right? So from there you can define functional derivative by using exactly the same trick. You just divide it by that factor of lattice spacing.
So once you do that, you never go back to this.
Exactly. Then you never have to go back to the discrete formalism.
integrate the action on the path integral,
yes,
you write it in terms of theta. You no longer write it in terms of size, right?
Well, you write, I mean, you'll think of the size as thetas, right? The action will still be written in terms of size, right? But now the size will play the role of the thetas.
All of these things will go through for the size.
Exactly. All of these things will go through the size. Then you can take derivative with respect to psi. Right? I have not introduced yet how to do integration over psi, right? Which is what you need for path integral. Right? But derivative with respect to psi you can take. Right? More importantly, derivative with respect to j's, you should be able to take. Right? Because those are also Grassmann valued. Okay, now I'll just write down the last relation and then I'll stop.
Sir.
Yes.
Sir, when we write down sine theta 1 is equal to theta 1.
Yes.
And if I compare this with the fx is equal to sum over n and f and x raised by n.
Yes.
Then what should I call this theta 1 as a, I mean, coefficient of what? I mean, at
oh,
zero.
So theta 1 is the, I'm playing the role of x. Right? So it will be like f1 theta 1 plus f2 theta 2 square, theta 1 square, f3 theta 1 cube and so on. Right? For x you substitute theta 1 because that's in the argument. Right? And the fn's are just calculated from the Taylor series expansion, right? 1, 0, minus 1 over 3 factorial. Right? So those are the ones you substitute and expand. Is this clear? Okay, now I give the chain rule. Chain rule. This says that if g of theta is an even function, then what is f prime? F prime is a new function, which is the derivative of that function. So f prime of x is d of dx. But to define f prime of g of theta, right, you have to take d of dx and expand it like this. So this is sum over n, fn, n, x to the n minus 1. So what I mean by f prime of g of theta is that you take this expansion and then substitute for x g of theta. Right? That's the meaning of this quantity over here. Is this point clear? So the proof of this is actually quite straightforward. So left hand side is del del theta I of sum over n fn g of theta to the power n. Okay? So this I can write as sum over n fn. So the first del del theta I on g of theta to the n, right? It's a product of functions. So you have to apply the rule that I gave. It's first del g del theta I times g of theta to the power n minus 1. That's when del del theta I acts on the leftmost g. Then you pass it through the first g, act on the second g.
So that gives you plus g of theta, del g of theta, del theta I, times g of theta to the power n minus 2. And so on, the last term will be g of theta to the power n minus 1 and del g del theta I.
There will be one minus one rule to the power g.
Yes, but I have taken g is even.
Okay.
So because g is even, so this relation is true only for g even. Okay, so because g is even, I can take it through like this. Now, again, we use the fact that g is even. Because g is even, all the del g del theta i's can be brought to the left, right? Because you had this relation that f times g is g times f if either of them is even, right? And since g is even, del g del theta I can take to the right, to the left. So all of these I can bring del g del theta to the left. Okay. So this then can be written as sum over n fn del g del theta I times g of theta to the power n minus 1 times n, because there are n terms here. In each of these terms I just pulled del g del theta to the left, and this is what you wanted to prove. This is del g del theta I. Okay, I just put it outside and sum over n, n fn g of theta to the power n minus 1. This is by definition f prime of g of theta. Is this clear? So let's just look at a few examples. Del del theta 1 of e to the power I theta 1 theta 2. What will this be according to this formula? So basically this is saying that think of this as an ordinary function, e to the I x. Okay. Take derivative with respect to x. Okay. That gives you I e to the I x. Okay. So that's this I e to the I x. Okay. And then you have to multiply. Now theta 1, theta 2 is your g of theta. Okay. That you have to take the derivative with respect to theta. Okay. That gives you this theta 2. Okay. Del del theta 1 of cos theta 1 theta 2. Okay, let's just check if it's true or not. Okay. So this side is del del theta 1 of what is e to the I theta 1 theta 2? 1 plus I theta 1 theta 2. Okay. So this is I theta 2. Where the del theta 1 of theta 1 gives you 1. What about this one? I theta 2 times 1 plus I theta 1 theta 2. That is I theta 2. So your two sides agree. Okay. So I'll leave it as an exercise to do del theta 1 of cos theta 1 theta 2. So what do you expect this to be?
Minus sine theta 1 theta 2 and multiplied by theta 2.
So theta 1 times minus sine theta 1 theta 2. So the minus theta 2, sorry, theta 2 sine theta 1 theta 2. Is this clear to everyone? Yeah? Derivative of cos is minus sine, right? So minus sine theta 1 theta 2 I wrote, right? And then del del theta 1 of theta 1 theta 2 is theta 2. Okay, you should do calculate both the left hand side and the right hand side and check this.
Sir,
yes.
It is inner function then similar rule as the ordinary differentiation.
Yes, so it's the similar rule as ordinary differentiation rules.
Whenever there is a
okay. But if you are careless and apply it to odd function, you may run into trouble. So let's do del del theta 1 of cos theta 1.
Minus theta 1. Minus sin theta 1.
Minus sin theta 1. Now let's check if this is true or not. How much is this? Del del theta 1 of?
Zero.
1, right? This is 0. Okay? What about this one?
Theta 1 minus
theta. This is minus theta 1, right? So these are not the same. Okay, so not everything that happens for real numbers holds for Grassmann numbers. Yeah? You should keep in mind. So you should only apply the result when it's supposed to hold. Okay, so if you have odd functions in the argument, okay, you cannot apply this rule. Okay, because the derivation of course makes it clear that it holds only for even functions. Okay, so next time I think I'll introduce the notion of integration over Grassmann numbers. Okay, and then we'll turn to actual formally part integration.